A long-lost Roman temple that sank beneath the waves, ancient tombs found in frozen Siberia, and cutting-edge science that revealed the face of an Egyptian pharaoh. Keep watching if you want to learn more. Hey guys, welcome back to ADBC History. My name is Dan, and I'm going to show you the amazing new discoveries that are making headlines this month in the world of archaeology. Firstly, a famous Roman temple where Julius Caesar is said to have once worshipped the gods is believed to have been found in the Bay of Cadiz off the coast of Spain. A team of archaeologists from the University of Seville used LIDAR and digital terrain modelling to scan the seabed in the region where the temple is said to have been located, and found a large structure about 300 metres long and 150 wide, which correlates closely to the known dimensions of the temple. The Temple of Hercules Gadatanus was originally constructed by the Carthaginians as a temple to Melkart, one of their own gods, but the Romans later came to believe that this was just Hercules under a different name, and so they worshipped him there quite happily. The importance of this huge temple in the Carthaginian period makes it likely that Hannibal stopped there to perform sacrifices before setting out on his famous crossing of the Alps. It is also said that Julius Caesar came here and encountered a statue of Alexander the Great, who had conquered the known world by the age of 23. Caesar is said to have wept, for he was already 31 and had thus far conquered nowhere. I myself am 28 and so far haven't conquered anywhere either, so I understand his distress. Researchers in Egypt have digitally unwrapped the mummy of an Egyptian pharaoh for the first time. The mummified body of Amenhotep I, who ruled from 1525 to 1504 BC, was discovered over 140 years ago, but archaeologists have refrained thus far from removing the beautifully decorated face mask and delicate bandages in order to preserve them. But now, a CT scan has been used to build up a high-resolution 3D map of the body that lies beneath. This is what old Amenhotep looks like now. Not great, but he has been dead for 3,500 years. The scans show that his body was in good physical condition at the time of his death, with no obvious wounds or injuries, which makes it likely that he died from an infection or a virus. Unusually, it appears that the pharaoh's brain was not removed during the mummification process. Most of the internal organs are usually removed and placed into decorated jars for religious reasons. The project was a collaboration between archaeological and medical researchers, and the lead medical researcher, Dr. Sahar Salim, said that what struck her the most about the mummy was how much his face resembled that of his father. New research suggests that an ancient Bronze Age city called Tall al-Hammam was annihilated almost 4,000 years ago by a meteor impact. Archaeologists have been puzzled for some time by a 1.5 meter thick layer of carbon and ash that lays over the city, containing shocked quartz and melted metals such as platinum, iridium, gold, silver, zircon, and chromite. This was clearly caused by an extremely high temperature fire, which no human civilization at the time had the technology to create. The debris which was scattered across the site also features a strong directionality in its pattern of distribution, which is to say that it's all going the same way, as if it had been blown that way by an explosion. Archaeological findings from the site were compared to geological records from Tunguska in Russia, where in 1908 a 50-meter-wide meteor exploded in the air with the force of 1,000 nuclear weapons. And this is now the leading theory for what happened at Tall al-Hammam, as it is the only known process which could have created such shockingly high temperatures at the time. The city was clearly important, as can be inferred from the remains of the palace and the city's monumental gateway. It's possible that this cataclysmic explosion was the source of local myths and legends about divine retribution and the destruction caused by angry gods, including some of those in the Bible. A beautiful collection of Iron Age coins has been found in Germany. They are mostly pure gold, with a few silver and copper examples thrown in, and their similarity indicates that they were probably all buried at the same time, which suggests that someone was trying to hide a very large amount of money. Burying hoards of coins in this way was common in the ancient world, as money could be easily stolen and most cultures had no reliable system of banking as we do today. What's interesting about these coins is that they're curved rather than flat. These little cup coins were apparently typical of Celtic cultures in the first millennium BC, The Germans call them Regenbogelschlüsselchen. Yep, thanks Germany. Which translates as cup coins. If you're enjoying this video, then take a moment to hit the subscribe button and the notification icon so you don't miss out on next month's archaeological discoveries. An investigation into the bones of medieval warhorses suggests that they were actually quite small. Large, strong horses today are often 16 or more hands high, or around 1.6 meters tall, but medieval warhorses were usually below 14 hands, or about 1.4 meters. This figure was found by averaging the size of a huge data set of horse bones, found at 171 different archaeological sites in England, and was published in the International Journal of Osteoarchaeology. Helene Benkert from the University of Exeter believes that it's because size wasn't necessarily the best factor in determining the quality of a warhorse. She says that neither size nor limb bone robusticity alone are enough to confidently identify warhorses in the archaeological record, which means it's unlikely that they've just gotten confused with the bones from other kinds of horses. She goes on to say that historical records don't give the specific criteria which defined a warhorse. It is much more likely that throughout the medieval period, at different times, different conformations of horses were desirable in response to changing battlefield tactics and cultural preferences. Professor Alan Outram from Exeter adds that selection and breeding practices in the royal studs may have focused as much on temperament and the correct physical characteristics for warfare as they did on raw size. A burial mound has been found in the Urano-Yujukska Valley of northern Tuva in Siberia, a region which is referred to as the Siberian Valley of the Kings by local archaeologists, in reference to the famous Valley of the Kings in Egypt. This Siberian tomb has been associated by experts with the Scythian culture, a people or group of peoples which migrated westwards from Central Asia into southern Russia and northern Europe during the 8th and 7th centuries BC, eventually even making contact with the archaic and classical Greeks. The bodies of a 50-year-old woman and a very young child were found within the tomb, as well as a number of rich artifacts, including various golden ornaments, an iron knife, a bronze mirror, and an ornate crescent-shaped piece of jewelry. The wealth of the objects found within the tomb suggests that the buried Scythian woman was of high status, probably a noble. The history of the Faroe Islands has been rewritten by unusual means. Where these days we often hear about archaeologists developing methods using drones, or lasers, or ground-penetrating radar, this team of researchers have studied sheep poo to determine that the islands were inhabited by humans several hundred years earlier than was previously thought. It was previously believed that Vikings first colonized the islands in the 9th century AD, but the sheep poo, which was extracted from sediment at the bottom of a lake, dates to the 3rd to 5th centuries AD. The archaeologists argue that these sheep must have been brought by Celtic settlers, as the islands show no signs of mammal life before then. And finally, an important discovery has been made by a very special archaeologist, this little guy. Yes, this hungry badger who lives in a cave in northern Spain accidentally excavated a number of Roman coins while searching for food. Some human archaeologists who were exploring the cave happened to spot the coins lying on the ground, which led them to find a huge number of coins from across the Mediterranean, made in ancient cities as far away as Greece and modern-day Turkey. This discovery has significantly increased the progress of archaeological research in the area, and has been published in a Spanish academic journal. I hope the badger was given the credit he deserves. If you enjoyed this video, then check out this one on gladiators in ancient Rome. My name is Dan, and thanks for watching this episode of ADBC History.